Blackstone Publishing presents Leonardo Da Vinci by Kathleen Krull. This book is read by Tavia Gilbert. Introduction. If I have seen further than other people do, it is by standing upon the shoulders of giants. Isaac Newton, 1675. Where do scientists' brilliant ideas and discoveries come from? Well, nobody lives in a vacuum, and ideas don't come out of nowhere. Even Isaac Newton, a giant of science if ever there was one, depended on what great thinkers before him had figured out in order to see further, to make discoveries of his own. People hear the name Leonardo da Vinci, and they think, artistic genius of the Renaissance. And sure, he created the Mona Lisa and the Last Supper, two of the world's most famous paintings. Yet for 30 years, the whole last half of his life, he spent most of his time doing research in fields ranging from astronomy to anatomy, zoology to geology, and botany to paleontology. Scientist wasn't even a word Leonardo would have known. People didn't start using the term until the early 19th century. He might have called himself a natural philosopher, someone who wants to make sense of the natural world. But he would have known the Latin word scientia, which means knowledge. Knowledge that explains the universe and the principles that make it work. Leonardo was very interested in scientia. Yet in books about scientists, Leonardo isn't always included. Perhaps that's because, in the history of science, Leonardo is like a bridge. He stands right between the medieval view of the world and the modern view, based on observation and experimentation. He looks backward to a time when nature seemed illogical, magical. He looks ahead to a time when nature is viewed as operating by rules and laws that can be discovered. Leonardo did, indeed, see further than anyone of his era. But whose shoulders did he stand on? And in turn, did his work, his discoveries, inspire other scientists? Chapter 1. So many things unknown. Europe in the Middle Ages. First of all, there were no books. No printed books, that is. Just manuscripts in Latin, tediously copied by hand for the rich. Peasants had never seen one. Most people couldn't read or write anyway. There were no bathrooms. Hardly anyone knew what soap or underwear was. The poor ate with their fingers. Utensils were for the rich. Most adults had no more than a few teeth in their heads. Almost half of all children died before they were a year old. Women, on average, could expect to live only until age 24. That's because so many didn't survive childbirth. In the countryside, the poorest peasants lived in extreme poverty and filth, 10 to 20 people to a damp hut. They slept on the floor, their farm animals, as well as rats, beside them. After a bad harvest, when a famine would sweep through, people starved to death. In cities, streets served as toilets and piles of excrement were left to mold until the next rain. Every few decades came a mysterious plague called the Black Death, for the hideous black blisters it inflicted. The epidemic of 1348, which killed one out of every three people in Europe, was ascribed by many doctors to the rare placement in the sky of three planets. Doctors varied wildly in training, and progress in medicine was sluggish. There were physicians with degrees from famous universities. Still, the books they studied had been written more than 1,000 years earlier. Other doctors had little or no schooling. Barbers sometimes performed surgery. And if a limb had to be amputated, pouring boiling oil onto the wound was the method used to stop bleeding. A urine flask was the universal symbol for physicians. They spent more time examining urine than anything else. Doctors knew how to set broken bones, but the surefire cure for nosebleed? Pig manure. 10 green lizards, cooked slowly in olive oil, were believed to heal an open wound. One medicine was made from earthworms washed in wine and donkey's urine.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.